You can bet your bottom dollar. Great programming coming up next on the Stewart Media and Entertainment Network. Stand by. Hold on. Talk at its finest, coming up next on the Stewart Media and Entertainment Network. In about 2 minutes, stand by. Guys are talking about. Stand by. A great show coming up next on the Stewart Media and Entertainment Network in about 30 seconds. Stand by. Don't go away. Stop, stop, stop. If they're talking about it at the barbershop, we're talking about it here on SME. Great show coming up in about 30 seconds. Don't go away. Stand by. It's time. Sit back, relax, and enjoy another great product on the Stewart Media and Entertainment Network. Yeah!
I'd like to welcome everybody to the Griz, and of course, I'm your host, Rashai Grismore. I have a fun and a very exciting show for you today. LeBron James says valuable MVP, open to interpretation, and you know what? I agree with him. I really do. It's an interpretation of how you perceive the MVP to be. Also, you know what? I was upset about this story, about what happened with the agent of Sam Bradford, Tom Condon. You know, we'll talk about that. We'll talk about why he said what he said. And then also, why is the Navy SEALs, why is the Navy SEALs, why are they in the NFL? What's going on with that whole situation? I love it, though. I love my Navy SEALs. Those guys, they're the men. They're like the man's man. But what I want you to do is sit back, relax, and enjoy me, and let's get it. Thank you, everyone out there, for tuning in to Me the Grizz, however it is that you are tuning in. The game came on or whatever, and who was that? The Raptors and Dwayne Wade and company. I'm watching the game, and I'm here to tell you, and I say this all the time, and I know that you have to just say, you know what, Grizz, I know what you're getting ready to say, Griz. Griz, I know what you're getting ready to say. You're getting ready to say that the NBA sucks. Yes. The NBA, it sucks. The NBA, it really sucks. I'm sorry. I'm watching this game, and I'm saying to myself, okay, what's really going on? Like, I really need for somebody to tell me what is going on with the NBA. What's going on? I'm watching these two teams, and I'm saying to myself, okay, so you're trying to tell me that the Raptors, they have two stars, but these guys, they're not really playing like stars. And then I got Dwayne Wade. Dwayne Wade is looking like crap. I don't care that before this game, Dwayne Wade, he got you 30 points. I don't care about that. Dwayne Wade is supposed to get you 35. Dwayne Wade, this series, is supposed to average 35 to 40 points. That's what he's supposed to do. So for you to sit there and say, well, you know, he averaged 30 points the last two games, I don't care. Dwayne Wade is supposed to eat these guys up. He is supposed to sit there and dominate, and it's not happening. I'm looking at atrocious play on the basketball floor. And here's the thing about the whole situation. The Eastern Conference really has not been a dominant conference really since, who was that, Michael Jeffrey Jordan? That was really the last dominant reign of the Eastern Conference. But one thing that I can say, and really going back in my mind, even though, you know, we're doing the Shaq and Kobe era and the earlier Tim Duncan, the East, yes, they was really, as a conference, wasn't all that dominant, but at least you had guys who could play. A series that comes to my mind was when Allen Iverson, when he went up against the Milwaukee Bucks. And I remember that series, and I remember who was on the floor. I remember Ray Allen, future Hall of Famer, probably the greatest three-point shooter that the game has ever seen. Yeah, Steph Curry, I get all that, but Ray Allen has done it at a consistently high rate. I remember that series. And then I remember when Vince Carter went up against the 76ers. You had good play. You had stars who actually showed up and played like they were stars. I'm watching this. This is crap. I don't care what nobody tell me. This is crap to sit there and watch this. And then I have to call out this youngster. Who is that? Justin Winslow? What? Why is Justin Winslow, why is he in the NBA? Somebody please tell me that. I don't want to hear, well, Griz, you got to understand, Griz, he's only a rookie. That's what somebody will tell me. He's only a rookie. I don't care about that. I don't care about that. At the end of the day, this is a man's game. Don't sit there and don't try to make excuses as to why he's looking like that. I don't want to hear that. I really don't want to hear somebody sit there and say, well, Griz, he's only a rookie. You know, be patient with him. So Magic Johnson, he was a rookie. Hold on. I'm not even going to even go with Magic like that, because Magic at least was at Michigan State for 2 years. So if we are talking about, you know, 1 year players or even high school players, let's talk about somebody like a LeBron James. Let's talk about people like that who made a immediate impact once they came into the game. Kevin Durant. These are guys that when I saw them play, I automatically knew, you know what? That guy right there is a beast. He is just too good. And I tell this story all the time. When I saw Kevin Durant play at Texas, I said, okay, why is he there? He's entirely too good. Even if we go with somebody like Carmelo Anthony, and I'm here to tell you, I'm the first person to get on Carmelo Anthony's head. I just don't like the way in which he portrays himself. He portrays himself like he's a superstar, but in actuality, he's just a scorer. So I'm looking at all of this, and I'm saying to myself, okay, this guy should be able to do more than what he is doing. And it's just not right. It's just not right that I have to, you know, continuously see guys like this play in the NBA. He is supposed to sit there and pick up the load for somebody like Dwayne Wade. Help him out. He's not doing nothing. He is awful. He should not be in the NBA. He should not. Players like this get coaches fired all the time because they just don't have it. It's not like, let me take that back. It's not that they don't have it. They just don't have it right then and there. That doesn't necessarily mean that they can't get it. I don't understand why these youngsters don't want to stay in school. If you look at Steph Curry, Steph Curry was in school for 3 years. Tim Duncan was in school for 4 years. Michael Jordan, school for 3 years. We're talking about the creme de la creme. Kobe Bryant, yeah, Kobe Bryant, he went to the NBA out of high school. But Kobe, when you look at his stats, like his first 2 years, and you match them up with Michael Jordan, totally different. With Michael Jordan, when he touched down in the NBA, he automatically was probably the best player in the game. Like, that was Michael Jordan. As soon as he touched down, he took off like Speedy Gonzalez. Andale, andale, ayiba, ayiba. That was Mike. He wasted no time. Why? Fundamentals. He got down to technique. I'm watching Justin Winslow, and I'm saying, wow. Now, people are going to say, well, you know, Griz, he's a rookie. I don't care about that. At the end of the day, you are a professional. I've always said this. I've always said this. I will never, ever sit there and denigrate an amateur athlete. I will not do that. Why? You're not getting paid. They're not getting any money. So how can I sit there and get down on a youngster who isn't making money? I can't do that. That's not fair. But once you become a professional, the gloves is off. I'm coming for you. You need to understand that. I am coming because I expect more. You're a professional, and I'm looking at him, and I'm like, this dude, he really can't play in the NBA. He's not good enough. So I don't want to hear, well, you know, he's a freshman. I just named you guys who were freshmen that came into the league from day one and put in work. Or at least I saw them play in college, and I automatically knew, you know what, that guy right there, he's the truth. I saw Kelly Winslow when he played at Justin Winslow. I saw him play when he was at Duke. I saw him play, and I'm like, this dude right here, they're talking about that guy right there. So you're trying to tell me that guy right there, you're talking about he's supposed to be this, and, you know, he's going to go in the lottery. I'm like, okay, good luck with that one. Okay, cool. Okay, we'll see. And we're starting to see right now. Now, I have to talk about this individual right here, and I'm starting to notice a trend, and I'm not liking it. Seriously, I'm not liking it. I'm the type of person, I love competition. I want somebody to have that Lucius Lion in them. Yeah, I know you like that. That Lucius Lion. Now, I saw the episode of Empire. Now, you can't sit there and tell me that Lucius Lion isn't a cold individual. He'll sit there, he'll dog out anybody to get to where he wants to get to. I love that. I love somebody who will sit there and they're going to go for the gusto. They're going to compete. Now, of course, you should never compete with your kids like that, but I'm talking about in the realm of sports. Somebody that'll sit there and take on the challenge. DeMar DeRozan? Nah, he's not taking on that challenge. Why haven't I seen this guy try to sit there and guard Dwayne Wade? Why? I don't understand that. Dwayne Wade, I'm looking at D Wade and I'm saying, dude, this guy is old. Why haven't you sit there and why haven't you gone after this guy? This guy is vulnerable right now. You're supposed to sit there and you're supposed to go at him. Like what Kobe did with Michael Jordan. Kobe went at Mike. Kobe was a youngster. Kobe couldn't even buy liquor. And Kobe wanted Michael Jordan. And Michael Jordan, he knew that. He knew it. Kobe was like, yeah, that's the guy right there that I'm emulating. But here's the thing. I want to demolish him. Like this game that I'm playing right now, I didn't even get any sleep. I want him so bad. I want this guy so bad. DeMar DeRozan, nah, he don't want no parts of that. I don't respect a guy like that. Seriously. And, you know, I really don't like saying things like that simply because he's from South Central Los Angeles. He's from Compton. I grew up in South Central Los Angeles. Compton is, what, maybe 5 minutes away. If you get on the 105 freeway, boom, you're there. You're there in Compton. So he's from the area. So I don't like to talk about, you know, guys that are from where I grew up at, because I understand exactly how hard it is to grow up here. And he knows better. He grew up tough. You can't make it out the ghetto not having some kind of fiber in your body, like having some cojones. I don't know what's going on with him. I really don't. I'm looking at him and I'm saying, this dude don't want to guard D-Wade. He's scared. He don't want to guard him. You supposed to sit there and you supposed to take on that challenge. When you see D-Wade, why am I seeing D-Wade go up against Corey Joseph? Somebody please tell. I don't understand it. I don't understand how he will allow a guard to go up against Dwayne Wade. You're supposed to take that challenge. As soon as Dwayne Wade, as soon as he gets going, you tell any and everybody else, look, nobody else have him. I want him. I see that with Kevin Durant. Kevin Durant, he's not going to always guard Kawhi Leonard. But once he see Kawhi Leonard, once he starts to see that he's starting to demolish everyone that he's going up against, Kevin Durant is going to be like, okay, I got to take him on. And then Kevin Durant, he shuts him down, and then he allow him to, and then Kevin Durant, he starts to, you know, not exert so much energy. He allows the defender, who is that, Robinson or whatever his name is, the bummy player, the guy that he's a two guard and he act like, I don't know what he's out on the basketball floor. I talked about him on yesterday's show. And once Kevin Durant, once he sees, like, okay, I shut him down. Now he's getting ready to get hot again. Then what Kevin Durant does, I got to go and I got to take him on again. I don't want to do it, but the competitor in me is going to make me do it. This guy, he don't want to do it. He don't want no parts of Dwayne Wade. I don't respect that. You have to take on the challenge. If you sit there and you call yourself the franchise player, you have to do it. I shouldn't see some dang on Corey Joseph. I shouldn't see Corey Joseph doing something that he should be doing. I should not see that. I'm sorry. People can sit there and they can get mad. No. You're the star. And you haven't even, he hasn't even played like a star. And on top of that, you know, while I'm talking about him, the boy needs a haircut. Why do I gotta sit there and look at him look like that? I'm sorry. I know it's not right. I know it's not right. But here's the thing. Maybe if he cut his hair, maybe he'll feel good. If he feel good, maybe he'll take on Dwayne Wade. I just don't like that. You're the young buck. You're the young buck. You got everything that you need. He got all of the athleticism. He needs to work on his game. He needs to actually learn how to shoot a jump shot. He really needs to work on his game. But you're young. You're supposed to take on that challenge. Like, I remember seeing clips of Michael Jordan. I remember watching Mike, and a player would do something, and then Mike would say, I got him. Phil, I got him. Like, Scottie Pippen was, to me, the better defender. But Michael Jordan's whole thing was, Scotty, you can do it. But here's the thing, Scotty. I know I can do it. I know I can sit there, and I know I can shut this guy down. I know I can. So it's not a slight against you. It's more of I trust in me. So I'm just not feeling it. I'm not feeling DeMar DeRozan. I'm really not feeling him whatsoever. And I can't believe that he's not taking on that challenge. Whether you win or lose, one of the main reasons why I respect Dwayne Wade is because when he and Kobe would go at it, he would sit there and he would lose some of those times. He would lose some of those matches. And he would win some of those matches. But his whole thing was, I don't care about that. I want to compete. I want to sit there and make sure that if we lose, we lose because of me. And even if, and let's just say, like I was talking to my brother, when he said, you know, DeMar DeRozan, he does get caught up in some pick and roll. I'm like, even if that's the case, he's like, He is sitting up there and he's not fighting through the pick and roll. If you really want to guard somebody, you're going to fight through it. I seen Kobe do it. I've seen Kobe. When Kobe really wanted to get at you and he wanted you bad, Kobe's whole thing was, man, you can do whatever it is you want to do. You can go to hell. I'm going to follow you. I'm going to be on you. I'm going to be here. And I'm not cool with that. I'm sorry. I'm really not cool with a guy who doesn't want to compete. I'm just not. Let's see. Is it time to go on break? Hold on. Let me see my time. I know I have been talking. Let's see. Now I got a little bit more time. So, you know, this NBA playoffs, with the exception of the game, who was that? Golden State, and I'm going to break that down. Damian Lillard really needs to work on his game. His game, he's good. Don't get me wrong. I really like Damian Lillard. There's some things that he really needs to work on. And then, you know, also when I'm watching the game, still, I mean, I'm talking about the Raptors. I'm like, what the heck is going on? Where are the big men? Seriously, where are the big men? I just don't understand it. I don't understand, and I understand that Valanciunas is out, but I mean, come on now, was he truly a dominant big man? And I know I speak about this all the time, but it's just the truth. I hate the NBA, and it's strictly because of guys like that. Guys who don't work on their games, guys who don't want to play in the post. And, you know, and before I go on break, I can't believe this guy. I can't believe DeMar DeRozan. I really can't believe that. Like, he's giving my city, he's giving Southern California a bad name right now. He really is. He really is. From Compton, he is really making us look bad. And the only thing I have to do is just go back to Kevin Durant. Roberson is getting obliterated. He is getting obliterated by Kawhi Leonard. What does Kevin Durant do? I got him. I need that. He has to see me. And then he shuts him down. That's what you want. But coming up on the Grizz, I have a lot in store for you today. I think y'all going to actually like this topic. Top five guards. And I'm talking about the top five current guards as of right now, going up against the top five guards in the 90s. Yeah. I'm going to break that down. But coming up on the Grizz, what is the Navy SEALs? Why are they in the National Football League here on the Grizz?
Love this game.
no big stakes. We're back, and this is the Griz. Thank you for tuning in to me on SME, however it is that you are tuning in. Who's that? Steph Curry. Wow. That's all I have to say. Wow. That boy right there, that boy got game. Wow. That's all I have to say. I can't believe that he actually did that. I really can't believe that he actually went out there and the shots that he was making was truly, truly exceptional. I couldn't believe that. The shot that he did on Aminu, I'm like, wow, this guy right here, he's cut from a totally different cloth on the offensive side of the ball. Now, I just said what I'm going to say about Steph Curry. I sat there, I gave him his props. But defensively, he was awful. Seriously, he was awful. C.J. McCollum was going at him. When C.J. McCollum, when he saw Steph Curry, he was like, "Oh, I'm in the candy shop. Oh, what candy do I want? Oh, I want that candy right there. Oh, I want that right there." And he was going at Steph Curry. He was going at him. And then Terry Scott's. See, I always talk about coaches. How coaches, they really, really play a pivotal role in the outcome of a game. Sometimes coaches don't allow players to be great. Sometimes they sit there and they hinder players from really maximizing their ability. Terry Stotts, he is that guy. He is that guy who sit there and, you know, prevented C.J. McCollum from really, really destroying Steph Curry. Like, yeah, Steph, you did this, but look what happened to you. We're going back to Portland, game six. That's what should have happened. But the coach, Terry Stotts, on the other hand, he didn't get the memo. He didn't. How is it that C.J. McCollum, he's busting Steph Curry. And then when a timeout comes, and then when the guys get back on the floor, you sit there and you put the ball in Damian Lillard's hand. That right there in itself is not cool. You prevented C.J. McCollum from getting his shine on. That's not cool at all. I don't like stuff like that. Coaches, your job is to put players in a position to succeed. You did not allow C.J. McCollum to succeed. Steph Curry was getting dominated. But you sit there and you put the ball in Damian Lillard's hand, who was like Klay Thompson defensively, like he's a two-way player. Klay Thompson, he makes him work hard. So why would you sit there and go with that matchup when that matchup is like 50-50? But on the other hand, McCollum versus Steph Curry, oh, you sit there and you milk that until they prove that they can actually stop it. See, that's the difference between Steve Kerr and Stotts. See, Steve Kerr, whatever matchup he can go with and to get the edge, he's getting ready to do that. That's what coaching is. You'll sit there and you'll see a Sean Livingston out on the floor. And if a guard is short, how tall is Sean Livingston? 6'7". If there's a guard that's about 6'1" to 6'4", Sean Livingston is going to use every bit of his 6'7" frame and shoot over them. That's Steve Kerr. He allows guys to sit there and show themselves. See, coaching is all about giving the players the opportunity to succeed. Like, if you don't succeed, then you can't sit there and you can't look at me. I sit there and I gave you an opportunity to do it. Just like what happened with the Lakers. With Courtney Lee. When the Lakers went up against, who was that? The Magics. And they threw the lob. And Courtney Lee, he missed that dunk. I mean, who knows what would have happened if they could have got that game. But he didn't do what he was supposed to do. He can't get mad at the coach because he missed the dunk. Dude, I put you in a position to succeed. You can't be mad at me for that. I did you a favor. I helped you. So you can't be mad at me. But if I'm C.J. McCollum, I gotta talk to coach and say, "Coach," and here's the thing. You don't sit there and you don't talk to the media. You don't tell the media, you know, coach did this, coach did that. No, what you do is you go to coach and you say, coach, I felt like you didn't give me an opportunity to be great. Can you please explain to me why? And then he'll probably say, well, what do you mean? I was going at Steph. I was going at him. I was dominating him. Every time I touched the ball, he fouled me. Why didn't you give me the basketball? Coach, come on. I'm playing good basketball, and then you put the ball in Damian Lillard's hand. We've seen that he struggles against this guy. Why didn't you trust me? Give me the ball. Allow for me to sit there and get the glory. Allow for me to sit there and put the game on my back. You took that from me. Come on. That's not cool. He needs to be fired for something like that. Here's the thing. They had a chance to take it back to Portland. They sit there. They got lucky because the Clippers wasn't there. Well, I'm not going to sit there and say that. Blake Griffin and Chris Paul wasn't there. So they got lucky. You had a chance to take it back to game six. Who knows? They probably, if this was done the proper way, they probably would have lost to Golden State in seven. So instead of getting put out in five, you get put out in seven. See, coaching. I preach coaching on this show for a reason, to illuminate and to highlight certain things that you'll probably miss. I have to point this out. This is a fireable offense. No, I'm not going to sit there and say that. It's not a fireable offense, but, you know, it's just not good coaching. And hopefully, you know, he learns from this, because I know one of his assistants is telling him, like, dude, you didn't do a great job in coaching. It's not a fireable offense. Byron Scott changing the offense in the middle of the season, that's a fireable offense right there. That is. But here's the thing. If Portland decide, because of that what I just said, that sequence, if they decide, you know what, we're going to let you go and bring somebody else in, I wouldn't sit there and be mad. I just wouldn't. Now, I just finished talking about Damian Lillard. And Damian Lillard, don't get me wrong, Damian Lillard, he can play. I look at Damian Lillard and I say, okay, he's not quite explosive like Russell Westbrook. And he's not as quick as Chris Paul. He's like somewhere in the middle. Like, he can do it all. He's a good player. He doesn't do anything great. But I'm watching him and I'm saying, man, this dude is a 6'1" guard. Why isn't he dominating Klay Thompson? There's no way that Klay Thompson should have been able to stand in front of him. And on top of that, Klay Thompson goes out there and he goes buck wild. How was that possible when you're a guard and you have the shooting guard who's able to check you defensively, and then on the other hand, still have his legs and still throw up three-point shots? What that tells me is that he's lacking. His game is lacking. First of all, if he really wants to take his game to the next level, and this is something that is a lost art in the NBA, you hear people talk about it all the time, the mid-range game. He doesn't have a mid-range game. It's either shoot a three-point shot or attack the basket. And then when he attacks the basket, it's not like he's like Russell Westbrook, who can attack the basket with veracity. He doesn't have that. And he really can't beat you off. No, I'm not going to sit there and say he can't beat you off the dribble, because he can do that. But he's not Chris Paul. He needs a mid-range game, and then he needs a floater. You can't sit there and think that you're going to be, 6'1", 6'2", and think that you're going to constantly dunk on people. You're not going to do that. Only thing, Draymond Green was just using the verticality rule. So he really needs to work on his game. He needs to develop a floater in a mid-range game, and he needs to be able to shoot going to his left pull-up. And then, you know, how Kobe Bryant, we all know that Kobe Bryant, what really made Kobe Bryant great was the fact that He would sit there, and when it came to that elbow, I'll give you an example. When Kobe went up against the Phoenix Suns and he hit that shot, that was his patented move right there. Elbow swing through, boom, jump shot, game. He needs to develop a game like that, a mid-range game. That's what made Tony Parker so explosive, because Tony Parker, he sit there and he mastered the art of the two-point game. I remember watching Tony Parker just demolish the Lakers. You like, man, how many pick and rolls is he going to go? What? Like, dude, you're on the side. You're going back and forth around Tim Duncan. And then, boom, 2 points. He mastered that. And you know, Damian Lillard, he doesn't have that. That's something that he really, really needs to get better at. He really needs to get better at the mid-range game, and then also being able to have the floater. Oh, man, I'm getting a little tired here. Nah, I'm not getting tired. I'm sweaty, though. I ain't even going to sit there, and I'm not even going to lie to you. So I want to kind of touch on a little bit of the NFL. You know, the one thing that I love about, you know, sports is that you can always pull from different things that has nothing to do with the sport. Absolutely nothing. You can pull from anything. And Dan Quinn, he brings in, and Dan Quinn is the head coach of the Atlanta Falcons. He has brought in the Navy SEALs to work with his team for 4 days. Now, for those of you who do not know who the SEAL team is, we're talking about the guys who went to go see Osama bin Laden. And we all know how that turned out. Hi, Osama. Bye, Osama. That's the SEALs. And then from the SEALs, you got SEAL Team 4, SEAL Team 5. And the people that killed Osama bin Laden was the famous SEAL Team 6. Now, the SEAL Team 6, or the SEALs, period, their core tools is mental toughness, teamwork, and stress management, and resiliency. That's what they specialize in. That's something that, and I watch Buds on the History Channel, and I'm here to tell you, I am a man, but watching those guys right there, I'm like, nah, like, I'm a man, but they're man's man. I'm watching them, and I'm saying, dang, really? That's what y'all gonna do? Like, it's night outside, and y'all in San Diego, and it's cold. The water's like 50 degrees, and the wind is blowing, and you're in the water with a log on you? Okay, yeah, I'm okay. I don't want to do that. That SEAL team, that's what they do. That's what the SEALs, that's what they're all about. So if you're an Atlanta Falcons fan, trust and believe me, you don't have to worry about your team being wusses, being scary. You don't have to worry about that, because one thing that the SEALs will teach you, they will teach you how to sit there and endure and be a team. So you don't have to worry about that. And I like the fact that Dan Quinn did that. If you go on CBSSports.com right now, you can sit there and you can see exactly what they were doing. Push-ups. They were carrying a 240-pound log, flipping tires. I mean, this is what the SEALs are all about. So if you're an Atlanta Falcons fan, trust and believe me, the SEALs, they're going to have your team right. I don't know about what they're going to do on the football field as far as skills, but the mental approach, oh, they're going to have that mastered. Because one thing about those SEALs, man, them dudes can speak like 7 different languages. I'm telling you, I was watching this stuff and I'm like, man, these dudes is crazy. Like, who would do that? Like, and then they love their country. Trust and believe me, y'all, I love the United States of America. But, yeah, I'm not doing no SEAL training for y'all. I'm just not. And when you hear these guys talk, they have a sense of duty. Yeah, I'm not going to do that. Here's a quick story. This is I want you to understand who the SEALs are and why I truly believe that when it comes to the Falcons, their mental approach is going to be A1. How many times have we seen teams lose games because their mental approach was all screwed up? Because guys allowed the moment to get entirely too big for them. We've seen it on countless occasions in the National Football League. This is the SEALs. They will hurry up and they will break you from day one. Day one, oh, so you thinking that you're getting ready to sleep? No, you're not getting ready to do that. Yeah, we're going to let you sleep for about two or three hours. We're going to have you up around 2 o'clock in the morning, and you're going to be on the floor or on the ground doing push-ups, and we're going to have water all on you. Like, the water system is going to be on you. The water hose is going to be there. You got to do push-ups. Like, during that time, and you have an X amount of push-ups you have to do. You got to do sit-ups. You have to run, like, miles. This is the first day of training. Guys sit there and quit. I would have been one of those guys to quit. I would have been like, nah, man. Nah, I need my sleep. I'm done. This is the seal. So, Atlanta Falcons fans, trust and believe me. You're going to be right when it comes to your team mental approach. You're going to be okay. But coming up on the Griz, I have to talk about LeBron James. Says that, you know, the MVP is open for interpretation. Next here on the Griz. This is the Griz, and thank you for tuning in to me on SME, however it is that you are tuning in. LeBron James says, viable and MVP, open to interpretation. Quote, I think sometimes the word viable or best player of the year, you can have a different result, or you can have different results. End quote. Here's my thing about that. I understand exactly what he's saying. If we're talking about valuable, LeBron James is the most valuable player in the NBA. He does entirely too much on the basketball floor. So I understand that LeBron James can sit there and in today's NBA can guard 1 through 5. Like, it's easy because you don't have true post presence. So he can do that. Steph, he can't even guard CJ McCollum. I'm sorry. He can't even do that. So that right there in itself is like, okay, yes, he's the most valuable player. But if we're talking about the best player, if we're talking about that, if we're talking about the best player of the year, it's Steph Curry, hands down. I mean, like I said before, anytime you can sit there and average 30 points, shoot 50% from the field and 90% from the free throw line, and on top of that, you're able to shoot 40% from the 3-point line. That right there in itself means that you're the best player in the game. I don't care what nobody says. That right there is an incredible feat. I'm not getting ready to sit there and say that Steph Curry is not the best player. Well, I take that back. He's the best offensive player in the game. But if we're talking about offense and defense, yeah, he's not even there. But now I take that back. Because he's so good offensively, it's like, man, Like, sometimes you don't even care about his defense. Like, his defense, his offense, it makes up for his defense. That's how exceptional of a player he is. But I understand what LeBron James is saying. And then you'll have some people out there that will say, oh, LeBron, you're hating. No, he's not hating. He's telling the truth. Sometimes when you sit there and tell the truth, it's not you hating. Like, you have a lot of people out there who are haters. This is not that hating moment. This is, you know what? I'm going to give the man his props. Okay, yeah. But I'm the most valuable player in the game. And if I'm LeBron James, I have to take this personal. I have to. He has to have that Michael Jordan complex about him. Like, you said this about me. That's how Michael Jordan was. You'd be like, Mike, man, he really didn't mean it like that. Michael Jordan was like, so what? And I don't care. It's how I took it. And I didn't like what he said. I don't like the way in which he looked at me. So now he got to pay. LeBron James, his whole thinking should be like that. He should say, you know what? So you guys want to sit there and say that, you know, Steph is a better player than me, most valuable player than me. You guys sit there and disrespect me by saying Kawhi Leonard for this year is a better player than me. Okay, don't trip. I got something for everyone. Y'all going to have to see me. You're going to have to see me. And so trust and believe me, I'm going to be ready. I know you better be ready because I'm going to be ready. So if LeBron James, if he is in that mindset, then looking at the Cavaliers, if, and this is a big if Tyronn Lue can sit there and actually like be a competent coach, then they might have a chance. But if not, I don't care what LeBron James has on his mind, they will not win. Now, you know, I found this commercial to be like very a telltale type situation as far as what I learned in college. Now, see, when I was in college, I was a radio TV film major at Cal State Fullerton University. And, you know, yeah, like I said before, well, what did I major in? Radio, TV, and film. Yes, a communications major, emphasis in radio, TV, and film. And I had learned that, you know, when you see an athlete, when you see an athlete or an entertainer, when they sit there and put their name behind a product, like they actually have to use that product. Now, in the LeBron James commercial, the Kia commercial, there was a fan who sit there and said, you know, I bet money that he doesn't drive that car. LeBron James, he has to do that. I learned that in school. You cannot be as a entertainer or somebody who is promoting a product, sit there and promote this product and all of a sudden use something different. Like LeBron James, he can't sit there and like promote Kia and sit there and then have a Lamborghini or have a BMW. Nah, he can't do that. He'd get in trouble for that. And so I like that commercial. I thought that, you know, that was pretty cool. And it was cool for me because that let me know that I went to school for those 2 years because I transferred from a junior college, Los Angeles Southwest College, and I transferred to Fullerton. That let me know that my money did not go to waste. But coming up on the Griz, I have to talk about Sam Bradford's agent and then also Bruce Smith. His number is going to be retired. And then I have to get off into my point guards. I have to talk about that. Current point guards of today against the 90s point guard. Oh, I have to talk about that next here on the Griz. The roads have changed to the sand. They're close but not far. Almost impossible to do. Describing the makings of you. Sunshine, blue skies. Please go away. But girl, I wish it would rain.
Player in this game, mama, don't cry. Long as we try, maybe things change. Perhaps it's just a fantasy, a life where we don't need no welfare. Wish with our family. Maybe it's me that caused it, the fighting and the hurting in my room, crying 'cause I didn't wanna be a burden. Watch mama open up her arms to hug me, and I ain't worried about a damn thing. With unconditional love, this game, in the eyes to see, no things change.
In an appearance on Stephen A. Smith, Sirius XM show, Tom Condon, the agent for Sam Bradford, took responsibility for the holdout and explained the strategy behind Sam Bradford wanting to be traded, and he wanted him to be traded to the Broncos. I understand that, you know, they have butt man, Mr. Mark Sanchez, so I understand exactly why, you know, he wanted to do that. Here's my thing. That's all cool, but one of the main reasons why I was upset was because you don't sit there and you don't tell an organization that, you know, you guys should have informed me that you were going to trade up and take a quarterback. It's like, if you're the organization, you like, who is this clown? Like, who is this clown? Like, he's comedy. Like, who is this clown? Like, you're a comedy. Like, get out of here. Who do you think you are? We do what we want to do. That's what had me upset. That's what had me upset with Sloppy. And I'm talking about Sam Bradford. That had me upset. Sloppy jersey. Like, when I heard that, I'm like, what? Like, how dare you? But I understand exactly what he was doing. It's just the way in which he did it, it was completely wrong. The way in which you handle a situation like that, you just ask for a trade. You don't sit there and say, well, you guys should have sit there and told me what you was going to do. What? Who do you think you are? You're nothing. You're nothing. You're a comedy. That's what you are. You're a comedy. You're a clown. Get out of here. So I understand, you know, where he was coming from. And then when you are, it depends on what site you go on. Now, Bleacher Report is saying that the Philadelphia Eagles, they were asking too much for the services of Sam Bradford. They was talking about 2 second-round picks and then some. So it was like, hold up. Y'all want all that for that guy right there? What has that guy done? But what it shows you is that the NFL, it's a very, like, it's a cold business. That's what the NFL shows you. The NFL is like this. Yeah, we gave you $50 million. Yeah, we gave it to you. But we don't like the way in which you played after this season. So we're going to cut you. That's the NFL. They don't play. It's like a what have you done for me lately league. That's who the NFL is all about. And, you know, it's a cold, shrewd business. That's why I love guys like Darrell Revis, guys who are very business minded. It's like Darrell Revis, his whole thing is, look, I'm playing for me. Yes, I want to win championships. At the end of the day, I have no loyalty to nobody. The loyalty that I have is to myself and my family. I respect that. I respect LeBron James. LeBron James, when it comes to business-wise, LeBron James is a great businessman. He understands the NBA. He understands the ins and outs. I respect guys like that. It's not like, okay, yes, I'm a big dumb jock. I don't know nothing. Like, what's 1 plus 1? I don't know. Maybe 50. It's like, dude, come on. And I knew guys like that. Like, dude, you was big and dumb. Like, how did you get into this school, man? You don't even know how to write your name. Those guys right there, nah, they're not that. And if they are that, then that means that they have a team around them. I mean, look at Floyd Mayweather. Floyd Mayweather can't read from what 50 Cent said, but here's the thing. Mayweather is making money. He made a lot of money, and he conned the hell out of us. He did. He conned us, and the man couldn't, he couldn't even read, but he made all that money. As long as you know what you're doing, or you have people that can surround you, that's surrounding you, guys that are in your ear, they have your best interest at heart. I mean, you can do anything. I mean, look at Ray Charles. Ray Charles, this dude couldn't even read. I mean, forget read. He was blind. But this man sit there and did things in the industry that people who had two eyes, who had 20/20 vision, couldn't even do. So either you can do it, or you have to have somebody that can do it. And so, you know, the NFL is a very cold, shrewd business. And I understand why, you know, the Philadelphia, why Mark, what's his name? Sam Bradford. Agent felt the way in which he felt. I understand it. Seriously, I really do. Bills to retire Bruce Smith's number 78 jersey. He's a second player number to retire or to be retired in Buffalo. The only thing that I really remember about Bruce Smith was the fact that in the biggest game, that guy didn't show up. He didn't show up. In four Super Bowl appearances, he only had two sacks. Now, we're talking about a guy who had 200 career sacks. That's the most in the NFL. He was the first overall selection in the 1985 draft. He was an 11-time Pro Bowler, two-time Associated Press, NFL Defensive Player of the Year, a Hall of Fame inductee in 2009, and he only had two sacks in the biggest games of, no, well, two sacks in the four biggest games of his career. What does that tell me? All these accolades that I just named off, it don't mean nothing. It don't. It don't mean nothing if you don't do it in the biggest game. It really doesn't. You have to sit there and take your game to the next level. And he didn't do that. I mean, and he's not the only one. I remember the Purple People Eaters, and I don't remember them because I actually didn't see them play. But I watch NFL films. I grew up watching. I remember Alan Page and the Purple People Eaters, and they would sit there and have this vaunted defense, and then they would go up against Larry Zonka and get demolished, Franco Harris and get demolished, and the Pittsburgh Steelers, and you like, okay, so if they all that good, then why they not doing anything against the creme de la creme? That's when you separate yourself. That's when you become that immortal individual. Same thing that happened with Peyton Manning. Yeah, Peyton Manning, yeah, you got the two Super Bowls, but let's be honest. You sit there, you got lucky. Let's be honest. You sit there, you got lucky. This last Super Bowl, you shouldn't even, like, I can't believe he actually won that Super Bowl playing that bad. And then let's not even talk about the first Super Bowl that he won, and he beat Rex Grossman. He shouldn't even win the MVP of that game. It should have been Bob Sanders or Kelvin Hayden, but they decided to give it to Peyton Manning. How many big games did Peyton Manning lose? At the end of the day, you always remember for the things that you did not do. And there was a lot of things that Bruce Smith did not do. But here's the thing. It's just not him. We're talking about Jim Kelly. He was another one. Yeah, you sit there and you're blowing guys out in the AFC Championship game. But what happens when you go up against the Dallas Cowboys? You get dogged out. What happens when you go up against, who was that, Joe Gibbs and company? You get blown out. And then the one Super Bowl you had a shot of winning, we all know what happened with that. Why, right? But yeah. So that's how I'm going to remember Bruce Smith. And then also, I remember Tony Boselli putting hands on him. I'm talking about Tony Boselli out of USC. Dun, 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 dun. That guy right there. And Tony Boselli probably would have gone down as the greatest tackle who ever played the game, if not for injuries. That dude was a beast, Tony Boselli. He was putting hands on Bruce Smith. I was like, wow, look at Tony Boselli go. I'll see you, Tony Boselli. But yeah, that's what I'm going to remember Bruce Smith for, not coming up in those games that he needed to really show up and show out. Like, don't wait for somebody else to sit there and do it. You sit there and you set the tone. You dominate. And, yeah, he just didn't do that. Now, I'm here now, y'all. I'm here. Now, I've been talking about the NBA. I've been talking about, you know, a lot of guards. This seems like the NBA is just guard-oriented. You sit there and you look at, you know, the teams that are playing. It's pretty much a guard-driven league. I remember growing up that guards could not win an NBA championship. They just couldn't do it unless your name was Michael Jordan, especially a point guard. You just really couldn't do it. I mean, don't get me wrong. You had rare instances with Isaiah Thomas and Joe Dumars. You had those guys right there, particularly Joe Dumars, who, you know, who won a championship. But when you look at the history of the game, no big man, no championship. And there were guys in the 90s, I'm talking about great point guards, who really, they just couldn't get there. Whether it's Shaq, whether it's Hakeem Olajuwon or Patrick Ewing or just Michael Jeffrey Jordan. And I'm looking at this crop of guards, and for me, these crops of guards right here is probably the most explosive guards I have ever seen in my life. And, you know, I'm not going to mention somebody like Derrick Rose because he is no longer that guy. But when he was the most explosive guard, point guard I have ever seen. And that's no disrespect to Russell Westbrook. That guy was just on a different level. But I'm looking at these guards and I'm saying, if those guards played in the 90s, could they do what they are doing now? Like, could Steph Curry win a championship during that era? Like, could Steph Curry and company sit there and win those amount of games playing in the 90s? No, I doubt it. So here we go. Top guards. So I'm going to break them down for you. So for me, the best point guard in the 90s for me was Gary Payton. Now, I've seen some websites that have, you know, John Stockton number one. No, I'm not going to go with that. I'm going to go with GP. And I'm going to go with GP on Steph Curry. GP the glove, he will shut down Steph Curry. He would get in his head. That would be, I would pay money to see that. Here's the thing. If, let's just say, hypothetically speaking, that if they was to go against each other, you already know that Steph Curry, he don't want no problems. So what they going to do? They're going to put Klay Thompson on Gary Payton? No, that's not going to happen. He's going to use and abuse him. Whoever it is that they tried, Andre Iguodala, no. People don't remember this. For those of you who are too young to know, and for those of you who are old enough to know, you know how great of a player GP was. GP was nothing nice on that basketball floor. That's why they called him the glove. Remember, he was, and that Seattle team was the only team that made Michael Jordan actually look like a mortal, like he could actually be killed. Like, Michael Jordan wasn't MJ. He wasn't Superman. He was like Batman. That was GP right there. That guy right there, I'm going to take him over Steph Curry. He would shut him down. And if Steph Curry did decide to guard Gary Payton, oh, that's just nasty. It's going to get nasty real fast because he's going to sit there, he's going to dominate him, and then he's going to talk trash. So give me GP over Steph Curry. Here's the guys who have the handles I'm talking about. And don't get me wrong, Steph had handles too. Don't get me wrong. He can, you know, with that ball in his hand, oh, he can do it. He has the handles. I mean, he has those handles where at the Rucker, it's like, ooh, he has those. But there's some other guys who, for me, have a little bit more handles than he has. Chris Paul and Tim Hardaway. Killer crossover Tim Hardaway. That's a matchup right there. We're talking about two extremely quick guys. Tim Hardaway, oh, man. What, when he was with, was that Rich Mitchman and Chris Mullin? Man, them guys could play. You got to remember the era that I'm talking about. These guys couldn't win because you're going up against Shaq. You're going up against Hakeem Olajuwon. You're going up against Michael Jordan. Do you know how hard it is to beat those guys? A guard, you're not going to be able to do that. Chris Paul and Tim Hardaway. Man, give me Tim Hardaway. Oh, no, that's a tough one. That's a tough one. Chris Paul can play. I like Chris Paul. It's just that when you want him to make that bucket, he just didn't. He don't do it. He don't. But I love his tenacity. I do. I love the fact that Chris Paul, he will sit there and he will go at you. I've sit there and I've seen him go at Kevin Durant and do a decent job in guarding Kevin Durant. That's something that, you know, DeMar DeRozan, he just don't know nothing about that. He don't know nothing about that. And like I said before, I don't respect guys like that who don't want to take on the challenge. Chris Paul, just for that alone, I'll take Chris Paul. Just for that alone. John Stockton and Damian Lillard. Ooh, that's a nice one. Now, you're probably thinking, well, Griz, you know, John Stockton, he can't mess with Damian Lillard, man. Y'all better come correct. John Stockton was nothing nice on that basketball floor. Man, just because he had the short pants, that don't mean that that man couldn't play basketball. That man right there could play. He could. Now, it all depends on what you want. And if we're talking about John Stockton being the primordial for a team, probably not. Because when you look at it, Damian Lillard, he has to do a lot. And, you know, John Stockton, he had Karl Malone, so that really helped him. But I remember watching them old school Laker games, and he was giving the Lakers the business. John Stockton was nothing nice, man. He really wasn't. Oh, I'm going to have to come back to that one. Because I got to come back to that one. Russell Westbrook versus Penny Hardaway. Give me Penny. Yes, it's just that easy. Penny Hardaway, what? We're talking about Anthony Penny Hardaway. That guy, before the injuries, that guy was nothing nice. That guy could ball. That guy had game. I remember seeing him go at Mike, and I'm like, I respect that guy right there. Michael Jordan had to come correct. Here's the thing. Look who he lost to. Hakeem Olajuwon. Look who he lost to. Michael Jeffrey Jordan. You understand what I'm saying? You got to think about this. Chris Paul and company, they're losing to the Houston Rockets. Like, even if I don't believe that Tim Hardaway would have lost to the Houston Rockets. No, it's not going to happen. So just for me even saying that, man, give me Tim Hardaway. He would not have done that. I'm sorry. It just would not have happened. Them guys could play. Those guys were more fundamentally sound. They are not as explosive as these guys are, but they're just better basketball players. They know how to play the game better. They can shoot the three ball. They had a mid-range game. They could put you in the post. That's what separates you. That's what they could do. So, yes, give me Penny. Don't get me wrong. Russell Westbrook can go. But Penny Hardaway? What? Penny could go. For those, like, go on YouTube and look up Penny Hardaway. Who what really comes to my mind about him? Remember Butch McRae from Blue Chips when he and Shaq? That was Penny Hardaway. Butch McRae, that guy could play. So yes, give me Penny Hardaway over Russell Westbrook. Russell Westbrook will see a guy who is more, I'm not going to say he was more athletic, but just as athletic, and who was a bigger guy. See, he has a lot of, you know, when he goes up against these guards in today's NBA, he's so big. He just bulldozes over them. He's quicker than them. But if he would have went up against somebody like a Penny Hardaway, you can't sit there. You can't bulldoze him. And he's quick. So what you going to do? You got to come correct. Oh, and not only that, Russell Westbrook would get put in the post. He would get put in the post against Penny Hardaway. Mind you, Penny Hardaway went up against Michael Jordan. And remember, they beat Michael Jordan. I don't care if Michael Jordan just came back out of retirement. A loss is a loss. So, no, you're not going to sell me on that one. Now, Kyrie Irving and Jason Kidd. Ooh, give me Jason Kidd. Don't get me wrong. Kyrie Irving has all the handles. Now, out of all of these guys, when it comes to ball handling, dribbles, handles, that guy right there has it. If we're talking about a guy from the Rucker League, you know, those guys from the Rucker, you know, they can dribble. Now, they can't shoot. They can't play no defense, but they can dribble the basketball. If we're talking about that, oh, of course, it's Kyrie Irving all day long. But Jason Kidd could play defense. Jason Kidd, a young Jason Kidd, was quick. Yeah, so give me Jason Kidd. I'm telling you. And I might be biased. I might be. But no, it's not even I'm biased. I'm basing this stuff on the fact that these guys, they couldn't win championships because of Michael Jordan and Kobe Bryant and Shaq. Chris Paul can't even get to the Western Conference Finals. Why not? Why can't he not get to the Western Conference Finals? He doesn't have a Michael Jordan. He doesn't have a Shaq. He doesn't have a Hakeem Olajuwon. He doesn't have any of that. Why can't he not get his team to the Western Conference Finals? And then Damian Lillard. I just broke him down. He has a lot of work to do. First of all, he needs to take pride in his defense. He don't even play defense. At least John Stockton played defense. He don't even want to play defense on Steph. He don't even want no parts of that. So how can I sit there and respect a guy who don't want to stick another guy who plays the same position as he and just sit there and win the MVP award? You're supposed to say, you know what? You the MVP, but I'm getting ready to MVP you. I'm getting ready to dominate. He didn't do that. So how can I have respect for a guy like that? And these guys right here, these guys, they battle. I can't sit there and respect a guy like that. So yes, give me John Stockton over Damian Lillard. Yes, I said it. I said it. I'm telling you, these guys don't even want to defend. The only person that's on this list from the old school who would defend their position is Chris Paul. Kyrie Irving, he don't want to defend. Come on, these guys sit there. GP, what? GP was shut down, Steph. Like, you see, here's the thing. People, they're getting caught up in the Steph Curry thing. And they're thinking that he's the greatest thing since sliced bread. Like, he's God. This dude ain't God. He's immortal. And you stick these old school guys on him who could play, who just as athletic as he is. We're talking about a totally different story. A guy who won't you. A guy who got, if he go up against you that following night, he's in the bed early. Because he's up thinking about you. He won't you. He won't you. He's dreaming about you. Man, I want this guy. He's playing basketball in his mind. He's breaking everything down psychological-wise. He wants you. And I got to go with the 90s guards. I have to. People, they're going to be upset. I don't care. But here's the thing. I want to hear what you have to say. If you disagree with my list, please let me know. But I'm looking at the defense. These guys sit there and they took pride in that. These guys in today's NBA, they're not taking pride. They're not taking pride in their defense with the one exception of Chris Paul. That's it. Those other guys, they don't sit there. They don't guard each other. Why do I have to see Russell Westbrook not take on the challenge of guarding Steph Curry? They're sitting up there and they're saying that this guy is this. This guy is that. As a competitor, you're supposed to take that as disrespect. Like, hold on. I can do the same exact thing too. Who does he think he is? I can do that. You're supposed to take pride in yourself. These guys are not taking pride. These guys don't want to take on the challenge. They don't want to sit there and be embarrassed. They don't want to fail. See, here's the thing. Failure, only thing failure is, it just gives you an opportunity to succeed. That's all it does. We all fail. We fall down, but we get up. We fall down, but we get up. That's all it is. These guys, they don't want to fail. They don't want to fail. They don't want to have somebody say, oh, you see what happened to him? This happened to him. Here's the thing. These old school guys, nobody was not going to be tougher on themselves than them. They was going to be more tougher on themselves than the next man. They don't care about what the media say. They already feel bad because they lost that battle. So what ends up happening? They're going to go harder the next time they see you. That's why I said I respect Dwayne Wade, because when he saw Kobe Bryant, he was like, oh, Kobe, you know what's up. You know we getting ready to get this thing cracking. Kobe knew what was up. He knew, like, oh, man, here it come. But what, I'm going to run? Nah, I'm not about to run. We're going to see each other. And once again, these guys had to go up against Mike. Mike was M. Bison. That's who Mike was. Like, Street Fighter. You know, I remember Street Fighter. You know, you got through the levels, but you had to see M. Bison on that hard level. I'm talking about easy or medium. I'm talking about hard. You had to see M. Bison. You knew that you was not going to be M. Bison or Street Fighter. You knew that M. Bison was waiting for you. M. Bison was like, you got to come through me. You got to see me. And these guys, they knew, man, we got to see Mike. Damn, we can't win that. How we going to be able to beat this guy? How? So, yes, give me the 90s guards. Seriously, give me the 90s guards. But coming up on the Griz, before I go, I have one last segment that I want to talk about here on the Griz. Set me back some sand of the roads I've tried to descend. We're back, and this is the Griz. Thank you for tuning in to me on SME. Amir Khan and Canelo Alvarez, the pay-per-view numbers came out. It was under 600,000 buys. Now, this is what this tells me, is that people overhyped Canelo. They did. They thought that he was the superstar parent to Floyd Mayweather Jr., and that wasn't the case. They really thought that he was going to be the heir apparent, and we sit there and we saw otherwise. Number one, he fought Amir Khan. Like I said before, the guy, he can't take a punch and he can't punch. And then this is the thing that really pissed me off. It's like people are sitting there congratulating Amir Khan for getting knocked out. Who does that? Like, he's the only welterweight to ever go up to middleweight. Sugar Ray Robinson did that, and what's your point? Henry Armstrong did that, what's your point? And these guys did not get knocked out. He get no brownie points because he stepped up to the plate and fought a bigger guy. And if you want sympathy, look between the dictionary between cow manure and syphilis. That's where you'll find my sympathy. He gets no sympathy from me because he went up in the ring from 147 to 160. Come on, that doesn't make any sense to me. No, it's like, He went in the ring knowing, like, okay, I'm going to get knocked out, but at least I'm going to get $13 million. That's what sources say he made. Come on. That don't make any sense. It really doesn't. And, you know, it just proves to me that Canelo, he don't want to fight nobody. Like, he's going to make an excuse as to why he's not going to fight Triple G. He don't want no problems with Triple G. He don't want no parts of that man. He sit there and he was like, oh, well, he could come in the ring after the fight. This is what he said. Oh, he could come in the ring. You know, I'm a Mexican. I'm going to do this and I'm about that business. Man, you ain't about nothing. Now, like I told you before, I'm in the boxing gym and the word out on the streets about Canelo is, according to my source, he don't like punchers. So I don't see him fighting him. Anytime you're a champion of 160, the middleweight division, and you tell a guy you got to come down to 155 to fight me, that lets me know that you're scary. You don't want no problems. So get out of here. I don't want to hear nobody talking about Canelo is this, Canelo is that. No, he is not. I'm sorry, until he face somebody who is actually his same size, then come talk to me. And not even that, you like, well, guys in today's boxing, a lot of those guys, they don't have the skills. But you had guys like Sugar Ray Robinson and you know, going up in weight and beating, you know, middleweights and stuff like that, not getting knocked out because they have skills. And like I said before, I told you, we're going to see how good of a trainer Virgil Hunter was. And we found out Virgil Hunter is not a good trainer. That's just my personal opinion. Yeah, he have Andre SOG Ward, but it's starting to make me look at, okay, did he really train Andre Ward? Because boxing is a very, very, you know, it's a very cold sport. Like I said before, the politics in boxing, it puts Washington, D.C. to shame, some of the things that goes on. So I don't know if he actually really even trained Andre Ward. I don't know. I'm just surmising. And then as far as the Triple G and Canelo fight, I don't even see, you know, he has a WBC belt. I don't even see them even allowing that to even happen. He's supposed to fight him, but I don't think so. I just don't. Boxing is a shady, shady sport. But I'm glad these numbers happened. Why? Canelo and Amir Khan should not have been on pay-per-view. I'm sorry. Who has Amir Khan beat? Nobody. This dude talked his way into a title. He talked his way into a title. And then people stupidly fell for it. This dude can't fight. I'm serious. He's a guy who talks a lot of trash, and I'm glad he got the snap box snatched out. Almost lost his life in the ring. I'm so glad he got knocked. I got the snap box knocked out of him. Before I leave, I got to talk about this. I've been talking about this story for a few days. Brandon Marshall, the Jets wide receiver, okay with Geno Smith. Bryce Petty being the quarterback, okay. And like, you're still not going to win, you know, a lot of games. You're still not going to go to, you know, the postseason. I mean, I kind of feel sorry for guys like this because it's like, okay, yeah, we got Ryan Fitzpatrick, but we got Geno Smith. It's like, man, like, who's the worst of evil? I mean, we got a veteran quarterback and we got a youngster who don't even want to pay his debt. Now, in the Game of Thrones, we all know what happens when the Lannisters pays their debts. You wind up like Robb Stark, like the Lannister pays their debt. Boom, you're dead. Like, dude don't even want to pay people. So it's like, man, come on. Like, you can't do stuff like that. And, you know, I hope Geno Smith does a great job. I don't believe that. I really don't. But, yeah, Brandon Marshall, you know, I feel sorry for you. You know, you're not going to go to the postseason anyway. But that's my time for today. I'm the Griz. I love y'all. And I'm out.